Welcome back to Endless Ocean. There's a penguin on our boat. Okay, what are you doing? Your hand isn't even near that penguin. You're just not even touching him. Okay, penguins are pretty cute, I must say. It's the flappy little wings, I think that makes it. God, just look at him flap those wings! I don't think Polynesia is near Africa. Oh. Well, okay then. I guess that makes it okay. So let's touch him. Because, why not? This is what we do here. It's kind of our job, I suppose. Yeah, touched the hell out of that penguin. Touched him real good. I don't think... Yeah, somehow I really doubt this. I don't think a marine biology degree does that. I think he just wanted fish, to be honest. From what I understand, that's mostly what penguins want. I apologize for the torso problems again. We will be touching quite a lot of things here, but we won't be touching everything, and we're probably not going to touch everything the repeated times necessary to complete the encyclopedia. We'll get a lot of it done, but I doubt all of it. Also, that penguin showing up means that now, random animals will show up on the top of our boat. The animals that appear depend on which quadrant of Manoa Lai you are in. We're currently in the sort of penguinish bird area, I suppose. In other areas, we'll be getting some things that are very different, and sometimes quite silly, in fact. And now we can move our boat. We can now dive anywhere in the entire sea, with some limitations. We're not going to be doing the Wi-Fi connection gate thing, unfortunately. It's actually well done for an internet multiplayer function on the Wii. No voice communication, obviously, and you still have to do the friend code bullshit, but for what it is, it's not really bad at all. But let's go read our mail. Rare items have been known to be found in the blue holes, apparently. Interesting. Every time you find a new location, you'll get a mail kind of summarizing the location, giving some information about it. It's actually kind of interesting if you have no idea about them. Just a bit of variety, bit of color to the game. So, at this point in the game, we have free reign to dive almost anywhere. We can dive anywhere, we can look at anything, we can touch anything. There are some restrictions. We can't dive at night right now, we lack some of the tools we need, we can't go cave diving, and there's a limit to how deep we can go. But, if you pursue what this game has for the story, you can unlock those functions. And it in fact doesn't take very long. The game doesn't really tell you where or what you need to go and do in terms of the story, but you can kind of pick up hints. Alfred Thorman there just mentioned items being found in the blue holes. So why don't we go towards that big old red X up there and take a look? Except maybe a little south, so we can get a bit of new locations on our way there. Now, technically, you could wait and watch this thing for hours on end, but let's not do that. So, let's get diving. When loading the dive, you can select which song you listen to while diving. You can only listen to a single song the entire dive, so make sure you choose well. Let's try listening to Prayer by Hayley Westenra. Now this is the main theme of the game. You probably heard it during the opening. Yeah, I think it's a very good song, actually. Very beautiful. A lot of the music from this game is by Hayley Westenra, who's a classical soprano from New Zealand. Won quite a few awards, actually. I think she's got a rather lovely voice. Now what do we have here? Oh my god, it's our first shark. The cloudy cat shark. Now, there are only 11 songs you can hear from the game itself while diving. So, them being very good quality is quite important, and I think they hit that one out of the park. They do get a little annoying if you're doing a long dive, because the songs will loop on and on. You can thankfully upload additional music via SD card, and choose your own dive music to listen to. In the future, I'll be taking your suggestions for that, though not quite right now. Now, this locale should look pretty familiar. We're getting pretty close to the blue holes. In fact, I think we're already there. Are you reading our mail? My god. Oh well. Now, you can see a little shiny thing there. That's a zoom point. Now, you can zoom by pressing the plus sign, but unfortunately, I forgot where the plus button was on the Wiimote. Yeah, I know. I guess I got brain problems. So, let's watch me try to remember which button is plus. I'm sorry. No, this is zoom. Zoom is kind of annoying because there's a lot of fish that can only be seen while zoomed into certain areas. And it's a pain in the ass to touch them all. Like this three-spot Daskalus. We've got a dolphin medal. Which summoned the bottlenose dolphin. The troll dolphin. Curious to be an asshole. But let's try interacting with him. We've got a dolphin medal now. Maybe this will build a report. Apparently not. Well, we could head straight to the lagoon, but we'd have to move our boat for that. So instead, let's look around a bit. We can dive to some areas around here that we couldn't reach before due to our boat being moved. Let's see if there's anything interesting around there. As you can see, there's this whole area to the south of us that we've yet to even touch. Who knows what wonderful fish could exist there. Thank you. Now, not all of you may be familiar with what exactly scuba is. You might be familiar with what scuba diving is. It's the people in the silly suits being underwater. But what is scuba? Well, scuba is an acronym. It stands for Self-Contained Underwater Breathing Apparatus. The first modern style scuba sets appeared in the 1940s range, 1930s. Scuba now tend to be pretty uniform in design. For a while there was some variety, but now they've kind of hit a peak where they're all basically the same. Their parts can be broken into a few units. The key unit is the regulator. The regulator is the breathing apparatus itself and the tubes that connect to the tank. The regulator leads to both a primary and secondary mouthpiece, often referred to as the octopus, as well as some kind of diving gauge, usually containing air level and depth information. And an additional line leads out for connection to the buoyancy control device, or BCD. The BCD is the vest divers wear. When going into the water, divers often wear weight belts which bring their weight above what their normal body buoyancy can support. This way, they don't stay stuck on the top of the water. They can actually go down underneath. Now, the BCD inflates from air with the tank using a control, allowing one to gain additional buoyancy when underwater to balance out the weight belt. By finding good balance between weight and BCD inflation, one can dive controllably and in fact also reach neutral buoyancy while underwater, allowing unimpeded motion. There's a few other key portions of the dive gear, though they tend to be a bit more obvious. Of course, there's the goggles. Goggles allow one to see underwater much easily. These goggles often have an attached snorkel as a just-in-case procedure if one needs to swim while low on air near the surface. Fins allow one to move much faster underwater. Gloves can protect your hands if you're touching things, or just in general, because you sometimes have to come into contact with rocks in order to properly maneuver. Now, you might be wondering, where exactly are we? What does our scenery look like? Well, if you move to the surface, you can kind of take a look. We're near a sandy beach with palm trees. A little sandy island. And we're surrounded by rock cliffs with some trees and mangroves. And there's our boat, the Gabiano. I think we just found something quite interesting. What have we here? Cowtail stingray. The cowtail stingray, Pastinakis saepen, is a large ray found commonly throughout the Pacific. Its most notable feature is a large skin fold on its tail. The cowtail feeds on bony fishes, crustaceans, aquatic worms, and mollusks, and are preyed upon in turn by various species of sharks, including the hammerhead, as well as the bottlenose dolphin. The cowtail's toxic spine is potentially very deadly. They're treated as particularly dangerous among stingrays due to its notable flexibility in moving its tail both forward and up to strike at what it sees as threats. This spine is essentially a modified scale, with two grooves filled with venom-producing tissues. The ray's venom is a protein-based one and can cause great pain to victims as well as alter their heart rate. The cowtail stingray is one of the prime so-called suspects behind the unfortunate death of naturalist Steve Irwin. While filming a show in the Pacific, he went too close over a ray, which, feeling threatened, jabbed him with its spine, unfortunately penetrating his chest cavity and heart. Steve reflexively removed the spine, which likely is the prime cause of his demise, as there have been cases in the past where people manage to survive stinger injuries to the heart when the spine is not immediately removed. Of course, it is idiotic to blame the ray or even overinflate the danger of the creature. Animals will, when feeling threatened, act in their self-defense. Steve Irwin's style was that of close interaction with animals, and he knew very well that he was pretty likely to die in his line of work, doing a thing that he greatly enjoyed. So while in this game we'll be poking quite a lot of fish, I'd like to stress that it's not something you should do while diving in real life. Look, but don't touch. It's for both the fish and your own benefit. Hopefully you'll take that to heart. stupid green Chromis. It's everywhere. Now, another key piece of diving gear, and a rather obvious one, is the diving suit. Diving suits keep you warm underwater, as well as protect your flesh. Now, you might not think it can get pretty cold in the water, even in the tropics, but it can. And having prolonged exposure to even 70 or 60 degree water can make you quite chilly after a while, and have health issues. But suits keep you warm enough that it's usually not an issue. Now, there's different types of suits. Most standard divers and dives tend to involve using wetsuits, which allow a limited amount of water in, which when captured is heated by your body, retaining heat, prevents the cooler water from getting in. Keeps you generally pretty warm, you're wet, but it's warm enough. Now, we've explored a fairly good range. It's not much further south we can go right now. And I don't think there's truly much left to see in the area, at least for the time being. So, let's head up back to the boat and go check out that dolphin. Box full of treasure. There's a lot of items in this game. There's a ton of items in this game. And they appear entirely randomly, which kind of sucks. In fact, it's impossible to 100% all the items in the game due to how rare certain ones are. Nobody even knows how many items there are in this game. Kind of crazy. You might wonder why the Latin for this means that it's the rump leg of Papua New Guinea. It's because people thought the Gentoo penguin nested there. They don't, in fact. But it has name primacy. Accuracy doesn't matter. That's the one that sticks for the species for all eternity. Now, we just received a diving guide request. Now, you can be a diving guide and take a tourist around and show them landmarks. And you receive a rating at the end, depending on how well you do. If you do well enough, you might receive a reward. Now, the issue with diving requests is that there is in fact a time limit in which you need to do them. So, we need to do this dive within 7 days game time. I believe, anyways. You'll get a lot of requests, and a lot of time you won't want to do them, and that's perfectly fine, since everyone in this area is apparently very chill about things. But the first diving guide mission is one that we're going to have to do, eventually. First, let's check out our penguin friends. Did they come for a ride? Yes, they did. Anyways, Catherine suspected that the dolphin was heading towards the lagoon. So let's go check that out. I'm a bit tired of prayer, so let's stick with the embrace of Manoa Lai. So the lagoon, that is to our north. I believe. Yeah, it's right there. So the bottlenose dolphin should be in here somewhere. Indeed, there he is. That's actually a legitimate problem, though it's more common with whales. And this isn't very shallow. This is pretty deep, relatively speaking. I'm pretty sure dolphins don't have problems with things being this deep, but I digress. It's a young dolphin. I guess it's possible. Check out my dolphin medal. Isn't it swell? I guess he likes it. So let's swim out. Now, there's another type of diving suit. The dry suit. They're pretty much the same as wetsuits, similar materials, except they let no water in whatsoever, keeping the heat in and keeping most of your body dry within the suit. Dry suits tend to be more expensive, and they're not very pleasant in warm weather climates. Not to mention there's additional pressure issues dealing with the enclosed air. Yeah, we let that dolphin out. And we've got a new friend. Well, let's go say hi to our friend here. Give him a nice, friendly pet. The bottlenose dolphin. The bottlenose dolphin, genus Tursiops, is the most common member of the oceanic dolphin family, the Delphinidae. The bottlenose is an extremely complex animal that, even devoting quite a deal of time here, I will ultimately fail to cover in depth. I'll try my best to do them justice. Bottlenose dolphins are cetaceans that live in groups of 10 to 30 members, known as pods. The size of pods can, however, vary wildly in size, with some family groups being as small as a few individuals, and others ranging up to 1,000. Dolphins feed largely on so-called forage fish, large schools of fish commonly preyed upon by ocean predators, such as dolphins and whales. Dolphins often harvest these schools as teams, though they are quite capable of hunting as individuals. Dolphins have, like most toothed whales and dolphins, the ability to echolocate, using clicking sounds and their return echo to determine the location and shape of nearby items. Dolphins have observed to have a very complex language, consisting of whistles, squeaks, body language, and environmental interaction, such as tail slaps on the surface of the water. As well as the group dynamics of dolphins would suggest, the bottlenose is incredibly intelligent. Its brain to body mass ratio is extremely large, on a level 2 or greater than our own, and it features many signs of high intelligence, including high-level mimicry, memory, the ability to learn new artificial language structures, the capability of monitoring and changing self-behavior, association and cognition of objects and symbolism, mirror self-recognition, the understanding of numbers, and the comprehension of pointing gestures and gazing, both made by dolphins and humans. They have been observed also using limited tools, which is rather remarkable, I'd say, given that they have no hands to speak of, as well as exhibition of cultures. Different dolphin groups will act in different ways. Behavioral traits are taught down familial lines and within the community, and it has been exhibited that dolphin groups will mimetically exchange certain acting traits. A good example of this was when a female wild dolphin, while being kept in an Australian dolphinarium, picked up tail walking from trained dolphins there. The female dolphin released actually introduced it to the wild population in the area, such that there are now several individuals who have learned the cultural trait of tail walking. Dolphins have an extensive history of interesting interactions with humans. They have often great curiosity towards us when we're in or near the surface, and there are extensive records and reports of them saving human lives when they're in danger by raising them to the surface, an action they will often do to members of their own species. The interactions can also get rather complex. In 2004, there was a case where four lifeguards swimming off the coast of New Zealand were approached by a shark, far from land. A bottlenose dolphin pod herded lifeguards together and surrounded them for 40 minutes as they swam to shore, preventing the reportedly fairly aggressive shark from approaching. Another interesting case has been observed in both Brazil and Mauritania, that of cooperative fisheries, where bottlenose dolphins drive fish towards fishermen near beaches. The dolphins signal the fishermen by rolling over once they have the fish in place, at which time the fishermen throw their nets. The dolphins are then more easily able to feed off the fish that do escape the nets. This is not a trained behavior. It's been going on in Brazil since 1847. Thankfully, the bottlenose dolphin is not endangered. They are believed to be globally rather safe, so long as the global fish population is secure, in part due to their high adaptability. A number of people, including myself, think that cetaceans such as a dolphin should be recognized duly as sentient species, and thus worthy of a modicum of rights equivalent to our concept of human rights. While their culture and evolutionary history greatly differs from our own, limiting the interactions our two species can have, their right to live is something that should be acknowledged and preserved. Of course, that's just my opinion. So that's the bottlenose dolphin. Really, rather remarkable creature. So, we could swim around a bit, look at some more stuff, see if there's something new around here. Things will change in an area from dive to dive. But I think at this time, we should head back to the boat. We're gonna be here again pretty soon. First he trolls us, and now he's friendly. Wow. That tends to be a kind of common thing across cultures. We've got a whistle. This is an actual piece of dive gear, by the way. Dive whistles do have uses for getting people's attention. Let's see if we can use this whistle. Let's see if we can do anything with it. First she talks of fish, and now I'm able to summon dolphins. It's a goddamn ship full of Aquaman. Wait, you didn't think it was gonna work? That's a terrible name. What name should I give him? I think, not a T. I'm gonna name him... Skippy. His name is Skippy. That about wraps it up for this update. Next time, we'll teach our dolphin some tricks, and we'll show a guy around. See ya.